2 years ago, I told you about this all-terrain off-road wheelchair called the Leverage Freedom Chair that I designed with a team at MIT for rural areas of developing countries. The trick behind the LFC is that to go fast, the user grabs down near the pivots and can push through a big angle every stroke, but as the going gets tougher, he can slide his hands up the pivots to go up steep hills or sand or mud.
These are just some of the 1,200 chairs that we've distributed over the past 2 years, all across India and to places like Nepal, Brazil, and even Easter Island. We founded a social enterprise called GRIT, and we started to shift our focus from the engineering and design of our product to figuring out how to run a company around it. We spent some long nights at our manufacturer in India figuring out how to truck chairs across the country, and even longer nights playing what we like to call wheelchair Tetris, trying to maximize the number of chairs we could fit into a shipping container. Now, as we started to grow, we wanted to do this in a careful and deliberate way. So we did a number of pilot trials. In 2012, we did one in Haiti with 20 users. And we shipped the chairs over. We had a lot of fun getting people rolling around. Here's Linda cruising around her courtyard in Port-au-Prince. Now, several weeks later, when we went back to do some follow-up, it turned out people were having trouble inflating flat tires. The bicycle parts that we use on the product, which are standard throughout the developing world, sometimes have very small variations that turn out to be quite important. And in this case, the type of valve used on the tires there just wasn't the same as what we'd seen in India and East Africa and Guatemala, where we had done previous trials. It was an easy fix. We were able to swap out the tubes and valves, but we're sure glad we learned that lesson with 20 chairs instead of 1,000. And as we continued to grow, we realized that we couldn't do everything ourselves. We were starting to ship large numbers of wheelchairs to countries all over the world. Up until that point, everybody who used our product had been trained by one of us. We taught them how to use the lever drivetrain to go over really rocky terrain, how to maintain the product using bicycle parts. And on this particular occasion, with 250 chairs to distribute in just 5 days, I knew this was going to be a challenge. Luckily, on one of the first days, this woman you see in the photo, who was one of the first I trained that day, picked it up so quickly, she helped me train everybody else in the group. And it was a reminder of how important it is to have really strong local partners, and that in fact, sometimes your strongest partner is your user, who can help you move your ideas forward. And the neat thing is, once you find these lead users, you get to do really awesome things with them. Initially, our focus had been on the work we were doing in developing countries. But wheelchair riders here in the United States reminded us that, hey, we want to go on bumpy trails, and there are plenty of potholed sidewalks that are difficult to get over in a regular wheelchair. They reminded us that we could have an impact here at home, helping folks like our returning veterans. We met Jeff, who was injured in a motorcycle accident, and last summer used our original chair to climb Mount Washington. Totally awesome. And he helped us open a broader conversation with wheelchair riders in the US about what they really liked about the product and what would need to change in order for it to really meet their needs. Well, we listened, and I'm really excited to introduce the all-new GRIT Freedom Chair. We've redesigned it so that the wheels easily come off and you can put it in the trunk of a car. We're using modern bicycle parts that you find at your local bike shop, and we're producing it right here in New England, supporting American manufacturing. With these two products, we've built a global platform for mobility.
When we started this project, we had to reimagine the wheelchair because as we looked in the whole assistive device space, we saw that up at the high end of performance, there's really capable off-road all-terrain wheelchairs, but they cost upwards of $7,000, much too expensive for developing countries. And down at the other end, there's low-cost wheelchairs, but they're hard to propel on rough terrain and they break down pretty quickly in the rough environments of the developing world. So what we had to realize is that we had to create a product that offered similar levels of performance as those high-end wheelchairs, but at the same price as developing world wheelchairs. And we couldn't simply adapt existing technology. We had to jump off the curve and create a disruptive innovation. And once we did, once we made that high-performance, low-cost product platform, we could adapt it to meet the specific user needs in wealthy countries and make the GRIT Freedom Chair. So what we learned from the LFC is that we can actually follow a process for engineering reverse innovation. We can use the constraints of developing countries to drive innovation of high-performance, low-cost products that benefit everybody. So this has become the mantra of my research group at MIT. And we're doing this to create new technologies like high-performance, low-cost prosthetic knees. What you'd get usually now in the developing world is a knee that has a locked joint, so people have to hobble along and it's really tiring. And what we're doing is looking at how can we use simple mechanical elements to make that disruptive leap to create a device that lets a person walk normally. And we're finding with a single spring and two friction dampers, it looks like we can replicate normal human motion. And by doing this, we can meet the mobility needs of tens of millions of people in the developing world, but also create high-performance, low-cost products for amputees in wealthy countries and tap into the $23 billion a year market for prosthetic limbs. We're also doing this related to irrigation. So the issue in a country like India is already 70% of the fresh water in the country is used for agriculture. And if farmers irrigate their farm by just flooding their fields, it leads to more water wastage. Drip irrigation is a great solution to this. You need about 60% less water to irrigate your crops. But the problem is most of these farmers live off the electrical grid, and pumping that water using solar power is much too expensive. So to make the disruptive leap, what we're doing is harnessing the same mechanisms that your body uses to restrict fluid flow to make low pressure and thus low power and economically viable drip irrigation systems. So by doing this, we can meet the needs of the 2.5 billion small-scale farmers around the developing world, help them grow more crops and get out of poverty, but also impact mega farmers in Iowa who can use less water and less power to irrigate their crops. And finally, we're also doing this to make clean water. So again, in India, where most of my work is focused, 60% of the groundwater is somewhat salty, which can make people reject otherwise clean water, and it just tastes bad, too. And it can also have pretty negative health effects. And again, the issue, when you take desalination technology off the electrical grid, it becomes too expensive because of the power systems. So to make the disruptive leap, what we've done is identify a different technology called electro dialysis that only requires half the energy per unit volume of water you want to produce. And so it looks like with this technology, we can make economically viable off-grid systems. So by doing this, we can start to address the needs of 2 billion people who lack access to clean or reliable water, and also possibly transfer this technology back to our troops who also have to make clean water in arid situations. To address these really tough social challenges related to health or agriculture or clean water, we can't simply adapt. We have to disrupt. These are wicked hard technical challenges. You know, they need science, they need engineering, they need innovation to create the high-performance, low-cost solutions that are demanded by emerging markets. And if we can do that, everybody wins.